Hello everyone, this is Eric, the Asian movie enthusiast, and welcome to part 4 of our exploration of Asian horror films released in 2016. This is the final part of this particular video, which means that we have reached my personal favorite Asian horror movies from this particular year. We have 8 movies that we will be covering tonight, and as usual, we have some variety here in terms of style, story, and types of scares. Also, the availability of most of these titles is actually pretty good. You should be able to find 6 of them pretty easily, either on physical media or on streaming. And by the way, I already have full-length reviews on my channel for most of the movies that we're covering tonight. So if you want additional thoughts, look up the titles on my channel and you should find them fairly easily. Now, I usually discuss honorable mentions in part 1 of each video when I go through each year. But there is an exception for 2016. When I originally saw the Kiyoshi Kurosawa film Creepy, I classified it as a slow burn thriller, not a horror film. However, over the years, I have seen it listed as horror on various websites like IMDb and online articles that give recommendations for Japanese horror movies. I was going to cover that film in this video tonight, but when I rewatched it a few days ago, I simply cannot classify it as a horror movie. It's a slow burn thriller for sure. So I'm putting it as an honorable mention. And you could check out my full length review of that film on this channel for more thoughts on that. And as always, titles for all the movies I discuss are listed in the description box below. The first title this evening is Sufficiently Offensive. It's always a treat to discuss a Hisayasu Sato film, and that film is called Hanadama Phantom, Japanese horror film from 2016. Our main character is a man called Teichi, who works as a projectionist at a movie theater that is about to close down. One day, he sees a girl in black reflected onto the screen. He checks the film but can't find her anywhere there. Later, he escapes, or she escapes the film reel and haunts the theater. He approaches her, befriends her, and discovers that she's a mute. He hides her in the projectionist room, but she later disappears. He becomes obsessed with this girl, who appears to be a phantom of some kind. So earlier in this playlist, we discussed a handful of Hisayasu Sato films, but one of them was Hanadama The Origin from 2014. Hanadama Phantom is a related film, but not a direct sequel, really. There are a few visual references to that film, like the weird red flower that people wear on their heads. But I don't think it's really a strict sequel, per se. It's kind of a related story. The plot is rather simple, and I do think that Hanadama Origin had a better conflict at its core that really got your blood pumping. But there are some interesting concepts in this one. Filmmaking is an actual theme. For example, the main character is an amateur filmmaker. There's also a movie that plays at the theater, and it ends quite surprisingly. At times, the story reminded me slightly of Marabito, due to the pretty but quiet girl who is found by a gloomy man who likes filming things. But I think Marabito was superior overall in its world-building and thought-provoking references. But there's just enough content in Hanadama Phantom to earn your interest, and there's a little bit of intrigue and mystery going on here. And the runtime is only 83 minutes, which always helps. This movie does have some weird sex-based humor, but it's absurd enough to be amusing. So, for example, the theater owner is kind of a pervert. You know, he gets a pair of panties from one of the girls, and he becomes obsessed with them. This type of thing is no surprise if you're familiar with this director, who has a long history of making low-budget exploitation films. So that exploitation feel, it definitely comes through while you're watching this. Another example, we get multiple shots of non-pixelated, full-frontal female nudity, which is rather uncommon in Japanese cinema, but they somehow pulled it off here. There are some moments of creepiness. One scene takes place at dusk and is like a natural blue hue that's pretty atmospheric. But the main reason to watch this film, and I am not joking, is the lengthy finale. That is completely gratuitous, depraved, and shocking. Let me repeat that. Gratuitous, depraved, and shocking. All right? I'm just telling you right now. One particularly nasty, offensive act of violence is actually was featured in a different Japanese exploitation film from the late 1990s. But it's even more insane here. And I don't want to spoil the surprise for the gorehounds out there. But my mouth was on the floor while I was watching the last like 30 minutes of this film. It's pretty nice to know that Sato still has it in him to make a film this weird and offensive in 2016. And the finale in this one kind of makes the first Hanadama film look classy by comparison. Definitely a very different movie. I mean, stuff like this is kind of a rarity, especially in the 2010s. Most normal people are going to want to stay away from this movie. I'm just warning you. But I found it oddly compelling. Fans of perverted, disgusting, violent, low-budget stuff with a distinct exploitative edge will want to check this out. So those exploitative qualities and my fandom for this director in particular are a major reason why I ranked this one so high in my list for 2016. So out of the 32 Asian horror films I saw from this year, I ranked this as number 8. Yeah, it's good, solid exploitation. Oh, I forgot to open my, hold on a second here. I got to open my availability doc. This one, unfortunately, though, it's not readily available. It's, this one you could buy on, like, Region 2 DVD from Japan without subtitles. If you could find a cheaper version of it, Japan has released in the past few years, like, cheaper versions of their Region 2 DVDs that go for, like $15. So if you could find one of those, it's not going to have subtitles, but at least you'll be able to watch the movie. And I think you would be able to enjoy this without subtitles. All right, our next film this evening is from one of our good friends, and you'll know who I'm talking about in a few minutes. And this film is called Kidan, Piece of Darkness, from 2016. This is a Japanese horror anthology. All right, and we've covered a bunch of Japanese horror anthologies in this playlist, like dozens upon dozens of them. So this is another one for you. It's an anthology of 10 short films that have a total runtime of 100 minutes. Since they are not long enough to be, I guess, thoroughly developed story and characters, it's similar in some ways to the Tales of Terror from Tokyo series. A few shorts were directed by Koji Shiraishi, our good friend, and the man who previously gave us Noroi the Curse, as well as a bunch of other documentary-style horror films over the years. And the narrator of this anthology sounds very similar to the same lady who narrated the Yamidoga franchise, and she's very good. I hope to hear from her again sometime soon. This is not an anthology that's going to wow you with its plot synopses, like something like Prayer Beads did back in the day, but it will entertain you with its execution. So let's go through some of these short films that are included in this anthology very quickly here, all right? Overtaking is the first one. It's about four friends who enjoy sightseeing at supposed haunted locations, even though they've never encountered anything supernatural. One night at 3 a.m., they are driving home from one of their trips, and they see a ghost. Has a few creepy shots. The very end of this segment is a little bit cheesy, I would say, but I still enjoyed it. Shadow Man, the second film, is about an old lady who is babysitting her grandchildren. She hears a loud banging noise on the other side of the house and she decides to investigate. This one is effectively creepy, and it did surprise me a few times. One of the better segments of the anthology. Tailed is about a young girl who's walking home from school, but she's freaked out by a man who stands silent in a park area and stares at her. This one's also pretty creepy, albeit somewhat repetitive. I like the gloomy rain atmosphere as well. Looking Together is about a person who is a high school teacher, and he ignores a woman in the hallway one day and something tragic happens. She basically hangs herself in the classroom. And then strange things happen thereafter. So this is another one that has kind of a spookiness to it, basic premise, but the execution works. The Woman in Red is a segment about, after playing some basketball, some schoolgirls are confronted by a woman in red. Kind of a generic setup, but the ghost is quite different from a typical ghost in how it moves. Kind of spooky, and it's fun when the ghost shows up. Empty Channel is about a young man who hears a weird voice on his radio. So if you're into that kind of thing, it's kind of creepy. Pretty good visuals and some weird moments. Whose Kid is the next one. So late at night, a teacher is left alone in a staff room and sees the spirit of a little girl. And, you know, you could shake your head at the generic premise in this, but it has a few interesting spooky moments in it and a few odd visuals. Let's Carry On is about elementary school kids who visit a cemetery to play a game of tag, but they get injured one after the other. This one's definitely a bit different from the other segments of this anthology, if only because every character is a little kid. I love horror movies involving, like, elementary school kids. I think it's interesting. Also, the way the kids react to their injuries is blackly humorous. Arguably the best segment of the entire anthology. And it has a legitimately scary camera shot at one point. Thief is about a girl who experiences some strange events involving a demented pregnant woman. Kind of definitely demented. It's pretty cool. A little creepy. And then finally we have Sealed. A young girl is perplexed that her closet keeps opening on its own. And it's pretty entertaining, has some energy to it, and is blackly comical. The ending is unexpected and fun. So this anthology is pretty consistent in terms of overall quality. There's really not any bad segments in here, which is pretty good for an anthology. And it has good use of silence at times. The music is eerie. The direction is solid. It's shot more like a moderately budgeted Japanese horror anthology. It does not feel like a made-for-television film, so it has a certain production value to it. So if you enjoyed something like Tales of Terror from Tokyo, you're probably going to like this as well. Now this one is available on Amazon streaming. All right, it's also available on Vudu. So good streaming availability for this. Okay, the next one is a pretty solid flick, and it's from Vietnam. I think the rest of the films we're covering tonight, I have a full-length review of. It's just, so you should know about these films already if you've been following the channel for a while. We have The Housemaid from 2016, a Vietnamese horror film. Set in Vietnam during 1953, a young woman is hired as a housemaid at the mansion of a French officer on a plantation. Most servants will not work at this location because hundreds of people have died over the years while working on the plantation when it was functioning at full force. Their bodies were buried in a forest that is part of the estate. And to make matters worse, some disturbing events occurred that are related to the owner's deceased wife. Needless to say, some weird stuff starts happening in and around this mansion. Now, the cinematography in this is pretty special. There's a lot of atmosphere in this movie. The visuals pop very nicely, even in the dimly lit scenes. Not only is the mansion itself showcased nicely, but the surrounding pond and forest is also captured in visually captivating ways. And consequently, most of the horror scenes are oddly beautiful to look at. If you like gothic horror, this is right up your alley. The movie overall has kind of a European vibe to it. And even some of the actors are Caucasian. And the ghost, it looks something similar to like The Woman in Black or something like that. She's dressed in black, has white eyes and a little crown on her head. And she's also pretty aggressive and uses physical objects and weapons against the protagonist. So it gets pretty intense. The lead actress is very good, I thought. I liked her. The story's something we've seen before, but it's spiced up a bit when an unexpected visitor arrives near the midpoint. And the final plot turn is pretty interesting. It'll make you think about some things that happened earlier in the film. I think this is just an all-around solid, good quality horror film. I think most people who watch this are going to enjoy it. The Housemaid from Vietnam, 2016. And this is pretty easily available. You can find it on Amazon streaming. You can find it on physical media. I think I have the Blu-ray release in my collection. Our next one here is, it's kind of special. It's a special one. All right. Now this one, availability is not great, but you could still find it at a relatively reasonable price without subtitles. And that is Snow Woman, also known as Yuki Onna, a Japanese horror drama. Begins on a snowy night in a mountain hut where two hunters have taken shelter. A snow woman's spirit enters the hut and murders the older man with her icy breath. She takes a liking to the younger man and tells him that she will let him live under one condition, that he never tell anyone about her. 1 year later, the hunter meets a beautiful woman who happens to be the snow woman in fully human form, but he does not immediately recognize her. They strike up a romantic relationship, but their past might cause problems for their future. So there have already been multiple film adaptations of this legend, the most popular of which is Woman of the Snow segment in Masaki Kobayashi's film Kwaidan back in the 60s. But my personal favorite adaptation was Ghost Story of the Snow Witch from 1968. And now we have this 2016 story to enjoy. This is more of like, it feels a bit different. It's more of like a contemporary art house movie. It has that vibe to it. Less concerned with the traditional storytelling and plot, opting instead to use visuals and mood to great effect. And it is great effect. Begins with a black and white scene in a forest with light snowfall. Almost no dialogue for the opening like 7 minutes. Then after that it shifts to a color scheme. And there's some pretty fantastic environments and tons of atmosphere in this. It shifts from like late autumn to winter to early spring vibes visually. Some fantastic shots in this, many of which accentuate the natural environments. The music uses Japanese instruments and a mix of ambient sounds and percussion that's both soothing and intense at the same time. It's a bit more sensual than prior adaptations. Contains some light nudity and lovemaking. Still pretty classy, though. Now, I would say that this is not a scary film, per se. More in line with, like, classic Japanese horror films like Kuroneko or Kwaidan. It's more like hypnotic and relaxing rather than viscerally scary. You know what I mean? The horror content is more thematic than anything else. I could see some people maybe arguing that this is a little bit more of a drama than a horror film, but I still think there's enough thematically and beneath the surface in terms of atmosphere to classify this as horror. I actually think this is more of a horror film than the Kiyoshi Kurosawa creepy film, actually, in my opinion. A woman by the name of Kiki Sugino directs and stars in this. I kind of wish more of her stuff was readily available because she has directing and acting talent, and that's showcased in this film. And you may recognize the lead actor, Munetaka Aoki, who appeared in Season of Snow and was a supporting character in the Rurouni Kenshin movies. I think Snow Woman is a very cool movie. I watch it. It's kind of like relaxing, and you let it wash over you. It's one of those. And it's pretty interesting how three Japanese horror movies that we've covered in this video so far are movies that are completely different from one another. You know what I mean? We got Hanadama Phantom, which is essentially exploitation. Kidan Piece of Darkness, which is more of a mainstream anthology. And we have Snow Woman, which is like an art house film that's like a callback to classic Japanese horror stuff. So I really enjoyed this. I did. And like I said, it's available on Region 2 DVD. No subs, but you can still find a cheaper version of it. And it goes for like $15, I think. Try Yes Asia. You should be able to find it there. All right, we're in our top four. We're in our top four now. And we're hitting some Korean stuff now, folks. The next one is called Horror Stories 3. It's an anthology, another anthology. This is the third installment in the Horror Stories trilogy from South Korea. It's an anthology of four short films with a total runtime of 94 minutes. I found the plot synopsis introduction, which gives us an idea of how this trilogy fits together. Horror Stories, the first film from 2012, was about four horror stories told by a high school student girl who was kidnapped by a murderer. Horror Stories 2 from 2013 depicted horror about death and the world after death. Horror Stories 3 from 2016 plays a role as a bridge between the first and second films because it concerns the past, present, and future. The wraparound segment of this third installment is delivered in a unique setting, borrowing from the science fiction genre of film. This is proficiently directed and acted from start to finish. Some creative stuff in this with an emphasis on futuristic visuals. So the wraparound segment's called A Girl from Mars. It's a space station wraparound segment. It's set in the year like 2416 or something like that. And you have a little Martian girl who looks like a human seeks asylum at a space station run by robots. And her family was murdered by a space army from Earth. But the robots are kind of hesitant to give her protection, so she decides to share some stories about humanity's vile nature in the hopes to convince the robots to let her stay. So it's pretty cool. Very cool segment. It's set in space. You get to revisit this outer space location in between other stories, and that adds a huge variety in locations and environments. It's pretty sweet. All right, now we have our first, like, proper short story here called Fox Valley. And that's set in ancient Korea. So you go from a futuristic setting to ancient Korea. And this concerns a town that's been dying of pestilence and starvation. The villagers believe that the nearby mountain is responsible for it. Apparently, the mountain itself is dying, and they're attempting to revive it. I like this story, mostly because it's interesting and it has some complexity to it. You have these odd beliefs of these villagers mixed in with some scares and mysterious events. Cool short film. Then we have Road Rage, which is set in the present day. A bickering couple are driving on the highway, but get into some serious trouble when they anger a truck driver. And this is probably the most relatable segment out of all of them in this anthology, because there are a lot of bad and angry drivers out on the road. And I'm sure, we all meet them on a daily basis. There are some legitimately effective moments of suspense in this one. I really like the ending. Very strong segment. Then we have Ghost in the Machine, which is about a child robot that temporarily malfunctions while babysitting a human boy. And the mother finds out and makes the decision to discard it for a newer version. But this older version may not go quietly. So probably the creepiest story of the bunch. There's some horrific robotic imagery to satisfy. I very much enjoyed this one. There are really no weak links in this anthology at all. Every story has its merits. In my opinion, it's my favorite installment of this horror stories trilogy of anthologies. And I think it's one of the better anthologies of the decade. A lot of people are kind of sleeping on this one, I think. And it definitely qualifies as a hidden gem, in my opinion. Now, Horror Stories 3 is on Amazon Instant, as well as Region 3 DVD. I really enjoyed it. All right, we're getting to the top of the creme de la creme, folks. Our next one is from Thailand, and this one is a standout film, I think. That is Take Me Home. All right. Near the beginning, we see a birthday party for a married couple's son. The wife seems pretty miserable, but attempts to convince herself and others that her marriage and family are great. Fast forwarding to the main plot, we meet a young man who has amnesia from an accident that occurred 10 years ago. He has no knowledge of his family, but he consistently attempts to find them. Early in the film, he accomplishes his goal and moves into the huge family house with his twin sister and housekeeper giving a warm welcome. But something doesn't seem right. The sister exhibits some odd behavior, and our protagonist begins seeing strange things. The first thing I want to point out is that the scares in this film are pretty strong. It really creates a sense of unease that contributes to a few legitimately surprising and intense scenarios. Even some of the ghost scenes are portrayed in an unusually visceral manner that kind of creeped me out. With regard to the setting, the house itself is very modern and pristine. It's almost like it feels sterile in some sense. But the filmmakers do something interesting with it that makes it pretty creepy. I'll just leave it at that. Script writing is tight as well. Our protagonist is thrown into situations that have no easy solution, so it's easy to sympathize with the guy. I mean, at one point in the movie, I said to myself, this guy is completely screwed, and there's nothing he can do about it. You know what I mean? There's no discernible way to escape this bad scenario. And that's one of the benefits of incorporating supernatural elements into horror films. You know, you can corner characters pretty easily. In terms of pacing, a little bit slow at the start, but the story and mystery ramp up near the midpoint, and it's very engrossing. Give this movie credit. It creates a tempered but exciting situation. Very proficiently made film, solid direction and acting, sound design is fantastic. On its surface, there's really nothing here that we haven't seen before, but it still feels fresh in how it's put together. Kind of like a chef who uses similar ingredients in different ways to change a meal. I'm going to say that this is probably the best Thai horror film of the last decade. So it's a must watch. I'm going to strongly recommend it, and it's on a variety of streaming sites. You could find this one pretty easily. All right, we're on our final two, the top two Asian horror films of 2016. Both are Korean movies, all right? It was incredibly difficult for me to choose between these two. I kept going back and forth. It kind of depends on what you're in the mood for. You know, ultimately, I gave the notch to the film that was more purely entertaining. But they're both pretty fantastic. And the first film I'm talking about, of course, is The Wailing. All right. A small village is plagued by a mysterious sickness that drives its victims insane, leading to brutal murders of their family members. After first suspecting poison plants is the cause, rumors spread that a quiet Japanese man from the nearby mountain forest may be intentionally cursing the residents. As the investigating officer watches his daughter fall under the same savage spell, he agrees to consult a shaman for answers. This was directed by Na Hong Jin, who previously gave us The Chaser and The Yellow Sea, and he's due to direct another film, so hopefully he comes out with the one soon. It's been 6 years now, dude. You gotta get on it. Beautifully shot film. The horror elements hit pretty hard. They do. Gets pretty intense in this. Starts off as kind of like a slow-moving mystery, but it has a lot of detail and subtlety to provoke repeat viewings. Gradually gets more intense until it becomes surprisingly uncomfortable and scary, with an ominous presence that envelops the entire village. The shaman possession rituals are highlights, in my opinion. One of the Wailing's greatest strengths is the story, which takes like a windy, curvy, snake-like route that kind of subverts some expectations at times. It masterfully creates a sense of uncertainty for the viewer. And that uncertainty accentuates the underlying drama because our main character is faced with some uncertainty. He has to make a choice. You know, it's an aspect of who do you trust. That's a huge theme in this. And if I was faced with the same situation that our protagonist was faced with, I would have chosen wrong. So the first time I watched this film, I'm like, you got to do this, and I would have been wrong. So let's just say that. Near the midpoint, there's a scene that would normally be the climax of a horror film. And the placement of that scene near the midpoint, it kind of throws the second half into doubt. Makes everything more interesting. Because you're like, wow, you're watching this. You're like, wow, is this the end of the film? We still got a lot of time left. And then it branches off. And I think the second half of the film was even stronger than the first half. So this is very good quality stuff. You may be emotionally impacted by the end as well. Such a high quality film. You absolutely need to watch it. It's widely available. You can find it on streaming and physical media all over the place. But there's one film from this year, an Asian horror film, that I thought just edged The Wailing out in terms of pure entertainment value. And that is, of course, Train to Busan. A fund manager, who was divorced with his wife earlier, decides to take his daughter to her mother in Busan as her birthday gift. They board the KTX train in Seoul, and it's occupied by a tough working class husband and his pregnant wife as well. There's a high school baseball team, a rich and selfish jerk, some elderly sisters, a homeless man, and a bunch of others. As the train departs, however, a spasmodic young woman boards the train with a bite wound on her leg, and then she succumbs. She becomes zombified and attacks a passing female train attendant, and the infection spreads, folks. It spreads. One of the big reasons why this hits my number one spot for the year is the pacing in this. It's just perfect. You know, these filmmakers do a great job of constructing a bunch of suspenseful and creative scenarios involving fast-moving zombies, and it feels pretty grounded, realistic, and deadly, while at the same time providing just enough downtime between the attacks for the viewer to kind of catch their breath. Script writing is efficient, it's clean, it's simple, mostly avoids dumb character decision-making and contrivances. You could nitpick it, though, if you wanted to. A few scenes do take place off of the train, but the vast majority of the film is on the train itself. Acting is very good, across the board, includes some extras that play the zombies, because I really like the people who play the zombies in this film, because they contort their bodies in weird and freaky ways. They did a very good job. Makeup effects are good. There is a noticeable lack of gore, however, for a zombie film. I know some people had a problem with that for this. I've heard complaints that the film's not violent enough for a zombie film, which is kind of understandable if you're going into it expecting that. But in terms of pure overall entertainment value, it's so high that I really don't have a problem. It almost relies more on suspense than it does gore. So that's just the way they went with this, and I think it works really well. And still, to this very day in 2022, it's Young Sang-ho's best film by a mile. It's not even close. So yes, this is it's a must watch, guys. It really is. If you haven't seen this, what have you been doing? If you haven't seen The Wailing, what have you been doing? Widely available on streaming and physical media. So there you have it. Those are my top 8 favorite Asian horror films from 2016. South Korea took the top 2 spots, which is the first time that's happened since 2010, when I rated I Saw the Devil and Bedeviled in the top 2. Those are kind of horror thriller hybrids. But if you compare that to Japan, Japan's taken the top 2 spots every year for the last 3 years that I've been doing this list. 2015, it was Tag and I Am a Hero. 2014, it was Puzzle and As the Gods Will. And 2013, it was Miss Zombie and Cult. So 2016 was kind of a top-heavy year, but Korea came correct this year for sure on their horror films. I do think that 2016 was not as strong overall as 2015, 2014, 2013, but it did contribute some of the best movies from the last decade. As of this video, I do think I'm finally able to tackle 2017 as well. I have now seen 32 Asian horror films from 2017, which equals the number of titles I covered for 2016. So it's good. And 2017 will probably be a little bit more consistent. I don't think it's as top heavy where you have like, you know, instant classics from the past few years, but you definitely have like a wider variety of like good, interesting stuff to watch. So it'll be an interesting year to cover. And I also have some addendum videos on Asian horror films I saw from previous years. So I got a good like 7 or 8 additional videos in this playlist that I can readily make and upload. So those will be coming out on a regular basis for a while. So yes, as always, folks, I will see you next time.